know, some times, you know, God does things intentionally so he can show his hand.
Amen.
And so many folks are ready to see something bad to happen.
Amen.
And God turned that thing around and worked it out for our good. And ain't nobody mad but the devil.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to continue teaching Sunday school from the topic of another Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. I believe the last scripture we was on was dealing with how Israel, God didn't want to show himself Israel, so they would not try to make any images because at one reason or the main reason that God didn't want to show himself to them, and so they would not create something that looked like him. Hallelujah. And in this day, there's so many different Jesuses.
Yes.
By the way of crosses with a person on it. People got shirts, fans, portraits. Little banners. We got the disciples and whoever else on the picture saying that it's Jesus. But those are different types of Jesuses in which the Bible does not preach.
Amen.
Amen. Where's the last scripture that we was on the last week? Amen. And it was Deuteronomy 4. All right, John 21. Verse number 4. All right. All right.
But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus.
So when Jesus came back, the disciples didn't know who he was. And so this is another indication that we cannot create a Jesus and put him on a picture, put him on a binder, put him on a shirt, put him on TV, because if the disciples that walked with him when he got up, they didn't know who he was, how can we then portray a picture to say that it's Jesus?
Yes, sir.
So that is, in fact, another Jesus, not the one of the Bible. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go to the book of Revelation. Jesus appeared, when he came to the disciples, he appeared one way. And when John saw him in Revelation 1, he appeared to John in another way. All right? Revelation chapter 1, verse number 13.
And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girded about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace. And his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars.
So you'll see that the Bible gives another description of Jesus. Now this isn't one of the ideal images of Jesus that's used nowadays, but that's still a Jesus in which we should create to be. Amen. And let's go down to Acts chapter 9. He showed himself to Paul a certain way as well. So these different ways that Jesus showed himself, he came in different ways so people would not try to portray or create an image to where they say, oh, this is the Jesus, or this is Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. We know that Jesus You know, we know that he wasn't, you know, he had color, he was a brown person. We do know that because it came through the seed of Judah. We understand that, but we don't want to try to portray a picture, because even some of these crazy folk that make Jesus and put him black, they got a long hair. But if, why would we say that Jesus is a man of color with long hair, or a white man with long hair? And the Bible speaks strictly against long hair. Why would we have a Jesus with long hair? The Bible says that a man should have long hair. It would be a shame. Let's go to 1 Corinthians. Amen. Y'all with me? What did I say? 1 Corinthians 11? All right. And verse number 14. Now, we got all these different types of Jesus with long hair, but the Bible says something about long hair. It don't make sense for us to make a Jesus. And we say this is Jesus of the Bible. Jesus speak against an hair or a man having long hair. All right, read.
Doth not even nature itself teach you?
Said, don't nature teach you
that if a man had long hair,
if a man has long hair,
it is a shame unto him.
It's a shame unto him. So we can't paint no Jesus or make no Jesus with long hair. The Bible says it's a shame for a man to have long hair. So that can't be a Jesus of the Bible. So that's another Jesus. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
All right, now we're going to deal with the Jesus that everybody going to be talking about rose up this morning.
Good God.
Jesus didn't get, he didn't die on Friday night and wake up Sunday morning.
Nope.
That's another Jesus. That can't be a Jesus of the Bible. Amen. Y'all with me? Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Let's read this again. And a lot of people base their theology and their doctrine based upon Jesus dying on Friday night and waking up early Sunday morning, or rising early Sunday morning, and that's not nowhere in the Bible. And people today gonna be screaming and grabbing their ears talking about you laid down late Friday night and rose early. They're gonna say about 15 times early Sunday morning. And there's no Bible to back that.
Amen.
So that's another Jesus. Amen. You follow me?
Yes, sir.
All right. 2 Corinthians 11, starting 1. Huh?
Would to God ye could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me. For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if ye receive another spirit which ye have not received, or another gospel which we have not accepted, ye might well bear with him. For I suppose I was not a whit behind the very chiefest apostles. But though I be rude in speech, yet not in knowledge.
All right,
where? 6.
All right, so you see there in the fourth verse that there's another Jesus that's being preached. All right? Now, let's go to the 15th chapter. 1 Corinthians. Now, Christianity is based off of a man that God inside of a belly, the God that got inside of a belly as a manifestation, as a man to die for the sins of the entire world, and to die for the sin of the world, and to be resurrected. That's what Christianity is surrounded by. That's the doctrine of Christianity. Everybody believe that.
Amen.
So if we want to believe that, at least we need to believe it right. Because everybody has their own. If this is something that we have to believe, we must believe that Jesus died and rose again. We have to believe that correctly. We can't believe it, you know, the way mama preached it or the way daddy preached it. We gotta believe it the way the scripture says. Amen?
Sorry.
Read the Bible, huh? 1 Corinthians 15:1, huh?
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preach unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. Now how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures.
He said the first thing that's very, very, very vital. One of the main things that we must know. Read that again, huh?
For I delivered unto you first of all,
it's the first thing I delivered to you. Uh-huh.
That which I also received.
Uh-huh.
How that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures.
How did he die?
According to the scriptures.
According to the what?
Scriptures.
Scriptures. So one thing we must know is how Christ died according to the what?
Scriptures.
Now, people say, well, it doesn't matter, you know, if he died on Friday and rose up Sunday morning, it does matter because we got to preach according to the scriptures. Is that right?
Amen.
So we can't say that Jesus, you know, when he was down there in Jerusalem, somebody robbed him and killed him or shot him in the head. Right? And then he woke up, because that's not what happened. Right?
Amen.
We can't say nobody was wrestling with Jesus and he hit his hand on a stone and died.
What?
We can't say, I'm only saying that. We can't say Jesus tripped over the donkey and cracked his head on something, right? We can't make up these things because that's just as important. The way he died is just as important of the time frame in which he died. Because the life was set up. He said, this is the first of all, read that one more time, huh?
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received.
Uh-huh.
How that Christ died for our sins.
How he died for our sins.
According to the scriptures.
According to how it was written. Not according to people's thoughts.
Uh-huh.
Read.
And that he was buried.
Uh-huh.
And that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
Rose on the third day. How?
According to the scriptures.
Now, we got to figure out what the scriptures say because there's a Jesus that's being preached. That he went down Friday night and rose early Sunday morning, and we know he can't get 3 days out of that.
Amen.
Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody else say something? Go to Matthew chapter 12. We're talking about another Jesus. Because then we got to figure out who is this person that died Friday and woke up Sunday or rose Sunday, early Sunday morning. What's Jesus in it? All right? Matthew 12 and 39, huh?
But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights,
as Jonas was what?
3 days and three nights.
3 days. And what?
Three nights.
Uh-huh.
In the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth.
So, he gonna be in the heart of the earth for how many days after night?
3 days and three nights.
Now, Friday night to Saturday night, how many nights? That's 3 days and 2 nights, Friday and Saturday?
Oh, Friday, Saturday.
Friday night and Saturday night, how many of that?
Two nights and 1 day.
So then if you get up early Sunday morning, we ain't got another night.
That's right.
So then we got Friday night and Saturday night. And if you know anything about the Sabbath, the Bible's on the Sabbath deals with the end of Friday night going into Sabbath. Watch this.
That's true.
When you study Jewish custom, the Sabbath was going into Sabbath. Mm-hmm. Let's go down to Matthew. So this is one of the most important things that we got to get. All right. right.
Amen.
You know that, right? And Sabbath, the seventh day of the week, observed from sundown on Friday unto sundown on Saturday as a day of worship. Alright?
Yep.
Now, read 28 and 1.
In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it.
It says, it was the end of the Sabbath. So if I go there, the end of the Sabbath deals with the dust down on Saturday night. So I got there from Saturday night transition into the first day of the week, and he wasn't there. So that didn't mean that he rose on Sunday. He could have rose up on Sunday because when I got there towards the end of that particular day, he was already gone. That's right. He was already gone, so we got to figure out who this new Jesus is that got up on Sunday morning, because that ain't what the Bible said. The Bible never said he got up on Sunday morning.
Amen.
Read that again, huh?
In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to the sepulchre.
All right, now, go to Mark 16. All right, 16, and verse number 1.
And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him.
Mm-hmm.
And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great.
Wait a minute. Now they got there very early that morning, and he was already gone. So the resurrection took place before they got there. Mm-hmm. Resurrection didn't take place when they got there, but it happened before they got there. Mm-hmm. Amen. Y'all following me?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Give me another one. Go down into John. John 20 and verse number 1.
The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark.
Wait. They came early, but it was what?
Dark.
So if it was dark, meaning that if it was that early, you know, we're talking about that late night Sunday going into late night Saturday going into Sunday, so it was dark when Jesus left.
God.
Because he couldn't get there another day, because if he'd have got up early that next morning, then that'd be even 4 days.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Oh Lord. Because if it say 3 days and 3 nights, that means that last night he had to get up out of there. This scripture I like most because it tells you how to look outside. Read that again, huh?
The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early.
She came early the first day of the week. Uh-huh.
When it was yet dark.
It was just getting into that day. Uh-huh.
Unto the sepulchre and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre.
It was he was already gone before they got there. It was nighttime. It was still the end of the day, transitioning to Sunday, the first day of the week. He was already gone before they got there. So ain't nobody seen no Jesus get up on Sunday morning.
God, no.
So if that's not the Jesus of the Bible, that must be another one.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Somebody else shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right. Now, go to Luke 24.
Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning.
Very early in the morning. Everybody keeps stressing that. Early, it was dark, early, and he was already gone. So let's transition to that day, huh?
They came unto the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus.
They didn't find him there that morning because he was already gone. Couldn't find him.
Jesus
was out of there. He was like, man, I got to be obedient to what the scripture said.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
So we went down. Hallelujah. We'll get that because we know that, you know, mathematically, we can't get Friday night to Sunday morning to get 3 days through night. Is that correct?
Amen.
All right. Go to Matthew 12 and 39 again, and then we'll go to Daniel.
But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth.
Will be in the heart of the earth. So now we got to understand that there, in fact, has been an issue with the religious system. It's been an issue with Christianity because everybody is preaching somebody that's not in the Bible. And let me tell you how Satan is. Satan will think that now, this, you know, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, that's our everything.
Yes.
We base our whole ideology off of a man going to the grave and rising again. But if we do that and we can't get it correct, we got a big problem. So it was Satan's job was to mess up the system and get people to believe and to think that there was a person that got the grave on Friday night. And then people are so comfortable and haven't even took the time to really do a mathematical equation to find out if I get 3 days and three nights from Friday night to Sunday morning.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
We haven't took that time to count out.
That's right.
So let me do it for you. Amen. Friday night, one night. Saturday morning, one day. Right? Sunday night, Saturday night, how many nights? Two nights. And then they said he rose early Sunday morning, so we can't even count another day. So now we only got two nights in a day. Alright. Let me show you how you gotta do this now because go down to the Genesis. We got a calendar like that. Got a calendar day and night. So you get your whole day. Now you got your morning and your night. They give you a day. We're gonna start off with the night. Is that right?
Yeah.
Alright, Genesis. Chapter 1 and verse number 5. Huh?
And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day.
He said the evening and the morning was the first day. Y'all see that?
Yes.
All right, so evening to morning becomes a day. Now, let's go to Daniel chapter 9, because the prophets prophesied this. And see, people don't do their study, and they don't do their history, and search the scriptures before they start screaming about he died on Friday night and rose up on Sunday morning. All right? There was a prophecy given by Daniel. All right? Chapter 9 and verse number 25.
Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks. And 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not from himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many of one week, many for one week, and in the midst of the week
he shall... Hold on. That's what I want back there. Read that again, huh?
And he shall confirm the covenant
He's going to confirm the covenant.
Of the many for one week.
With many,
With many for one week.
Uh-huh.
And in the midst of the week.
In the midst of the week.
He shall cause the sacrifice.
He shall cause the sacrifice.
And the oblation to cease.
Uh-huh.
And for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate.
So you'll see that it was prophesied that Jesus was going to die where? In the midst of the week. Now we know Friday can't be the midst because this is towards the end. And people nowadays call it the weekend, going into the weekend. So Friday can't be the midst of the week. So if it was prophesied that, and this is the thing. People don't study the scriptures. People don't study it. People will get something. Go to 1 Timothy. All right. What is that? 2:15.
Notwithstanding.
What was that? 1 Timothy. Second to me.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. All right. 2:15, huh?
Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
People get right and divide, they don't study.
That's right. Amen.
And then, you explain in the scripture, and they try to fight you and debate you over it and know they're wrong.
Yes, sir.
Go to Matthew 22. Matthew 22:29. We got to get to a place now. If one thing going to get right, you got to get this death, burial, and resurrection right.
Yes,
if you get one thing right, you want to study that and make sure you know that he died on a Friday night and raised up early Sunday morning. He died in the midst of the week. We will find out if it's the midst of the week that it gets you 3 days and 3 nights before he rose, or if it's Friday and Sunday. Amen. Alright, read,
Jesus answered and said unto them, ye do err, not knowing the scriptures.
He said, you err because you what?
Do not know the scriptures.
So when you don't study and show thyself approved on God so you can be able to write the Bible scriptures, then you err because you don't know. And a lot of people are in error because they don't know the scriptures.
Amen.
And I'm actually happy that a lot of these churches are closed down so they won't be preaching that anymore.
Amen.
They wouldn't be able to preach that a lot. And I believe God got a setup like that because he knows someone wasn't be able to go in there and preach today. He was scared they're going to get the flu or whatever they got. So they ain't got a chance to preach that false doctrine because he died on Friday night and rose up early Sunday morning. Because it ain't never happened. Amen.
Amen.
And it ain't gonna never happen. No matter how much you need to preach, you can't make that come alive. Read that scripture again, huh?
Jesus answered and said unto them, ye do err.
You do err,
Not knowing the scriptures.
Not knowing the scriptures,
Nor the power of God.
Nor the power of God. Because if you don't know the scriptures, you can't understand God's power.
Amen. Not at all.
And that goes for the same people that say people should go to church during this hour. You don't know the power of God because you ain't read the scriptures.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Because if you knew the scriptures, you would know the power of God. You know that God is a healer.
Yes.
That's right.
It's the truth.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, go back to Daniel so we can read this again and make sure we got it.
Yes,
Then we're going to count it up to make sure we got the math right. All right? 9 to 25, huh?
Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks and 72 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall even in troublous times. And after 72 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. And the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. And for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate.
So in the middle of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. So we'll find that happened actually in the Gospels. Amen. Now let's go to John, because he became the Lamb, and that was that sacrifice. We'll find that in John chapter 1, in verse number 29.
The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, Behold, the Lamb of God.
Behold what?
The Lamb of God.
That was the sacrifice of the middle of the week. Now go to Revelation 13 and 8.
And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world.
Lamb, that's the one that Daniel was talking about. Mm-hmm. The sacrifice in the middle of the week. Now, let's do the math. And I don't have my board, so y'all gonna have to help me. And use your fingers. Amen. The midst of the week is considered, I guess, the fourth day, which is considered Wednesday, right? So if the Bible said that he was going to go down and he got beat, it was night when he got beat and put in the on the grave. Wednesday night will be what? All right, put two hands up so we can get it. Your right hand going to be the night. Your left hand going to be the day. All right.
Bless you.
All right. Wednesday night. Give me one night. All right. Just one hand. All right. Y'all all right? All right. Wednesday, then you go Thursday morning. That's that day that you're dealing with. All right. So you got Wednesday night and Thursday morning. All right. Then you got Thursday night. I'll give you how many nights. All right. So then we got Wednesday night, Thursday morning. Wednesday night. Where we headed? Okay. Wednesday night, Thursday morning, and then Thursday night. Then you got Friday morning. Y'all see that? All right. Friday morning, then you got Friday night. All right. Then you got 3 nights there. And then you got Saturday morning. 3 days, 3 nights.
Okay.
He was gone by that night. So he wasn't in the grave for that night. He was gone by the night. So that's your 3 days and 3 nights. From Wednesday evening to Saturday. Amen.
Amen.
He stayed in there that Saturday daytime, but he was gone before that evening hit, so he ain't never get up Sunday morning. He was gone before Sunday. He was gone before Sunday morning. That's easy. That's easy math. That's real math. I ain't no math teacher. Get Fred Wilder to do that. But I know what 3 days and 3 nights mean. Amen. Y'all see that? All right. That's plain. All right, so we can't, and for those of y'all watching, you can't say that Friday night no more. Sunday morning, just learn that wasn't right. All right, now, behold the Lamb of God. Now, go to Exodus chapter 12.
Good Friday.
Yeah, that's what we call a Good Friday. If you want to call it good something, it'd be Good Wednesday.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
So, everybody get days off. Good Friday. We got Good Friday on. One of the brothers, I said, preach y'all, they said, yes, sir. They said, the Good Friday, so I'll be awesome. I guess everything you get paid on Friday, anybody get paid on Friday, that's a Good Friday. Good Friday. If they had a restaurant, TGIF, thank God it's Friday. Jesus ain't never died on Friday. But he died, he probably died now on Friday, every Friday would be on. Tells him five, Good Friday, he gets crucified. Bible says, watch it, go to Revelation chapter 11. Revelation 11, I think that's 8.
And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Solomon, Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified.
Y'all see that? Where also, read that again, huh?
And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Solomon, Egypt, uh-huh, where also our Lord was crucified.
So he been crucified today. Or people talk about he died Friday night and rose early Sunday morning. That's another crucifixion. Mm-mm. Crucified. Another Jesus. So we got to get a clear and precise understanding of who Jesus really is and who he's really not. Because a lot of people talk about a Jesus that's not, and not a Jesus that was,
Amen,
and not a Jesus that is.
It is, yes.
Amen. Y'all following?
Yes, sir.
Exodus 12 and 1, huh?
And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the tenth day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening.
Kill it in the evening. So we know that Jesus, in fact, was the lamb. And Bible says this is synonymous to that. He died in the evening, but they didn't want them to leave anything until the morning. Watch this, read, huh?
And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two signposts and on the upper doorposts of the houses wherein they shall eat it. And they shall eat the flesh in that night.
This deal with communion. That's why we don't take communion in the day. We'll take that night.
Roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herb they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and with the pertinence thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning.
Wait a minute. I want you to give it at night, eat it, and I don't want you to let anything remain until when?
The morning.
So that's the synonymous to Jesus. He died, he didn't get up in the morning because he wasn't supposed to turn over to the morning.
My God.
That's plain. Read that again, huh?
And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the
don't
morning.
Don't let any of it remain until the morning. So to make sure that if the lamb is killed and slain, as the Bible says, he said, I don't want you to let any of it remain until the morning. Amen. Can we say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
All right, now, go down there to Acts chapter 2. All right. It was very important that the writers would always say that same Jesus or the same Jesus.
Right.
Because it was pretty obvious that there were other Jesuses being preached. So it was very important when they would write and they would say, listen, that same Jesus or this same Jesus. You follow what I'm saying? All right. Acts chapter 2 and 36.
Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God had made that same Jesus whom he had crucified, both Lord and Christ.
That what Jesus?
That
same. Because he said, I want this thing to be consistent. I don't want you to have any other types of Jesuses. No other. I don't want you to say nothing about Jesus this, Jesus that, unless it's dealing with the scripture. So I said, that same Jesus. Y'all follow me?
Amen.
Because that Jesus Friday night, Sunday morning, that's not the Jesus of the Bible. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Acts chapter 17. Acts 17 and 3,
Opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach to you,
this Jesus that I'm preaching to you now, that's the Jesus who I want you to preach. We don't need no other Jesus out there being preached except the word of the Bible. Amen.
Amen.
All right? Now, go to the book of Acts chapter 1. Alright. Acts chapter 1 and verse number 11.
Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
Read that again,
Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven?
Are you still gazing up in heaven? This same Jesus. Y'all see that? All right, go down to Acts chapter 2, 32,
This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we all are witnesses.
So you'll see that it says, this Jesus, this same Jesus. This Jesus, that Jesus that I'm preaching. This same Jesus that I'm preaching, because he want to make sure that there's no other Jesus being preached, because it's pretty clear that if he was saying that then, somebody was preaching a different Jesus then. Very clear that somebody had been preaching another Jesus during that time. Amen.
Yes, yes.
All right, go to Galatians 1. Galatians chapter 1. Alright? They're trying to make us famous. All the news stations outside. We ain't talking to nobody.
No.
I want to get saved. Y'all come and get saved. We ain't talking to nothing. Galatians 1 and verse number 6.
I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. Which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and will pervert the gospel of Christ.
So he's saying that people out there preaching another gospel. Different Jesus is being preached. He said, I don't want you to be a part of that another gospel, but I want you to preach this message that I'm preaching. So this is why, when we as a body, we have National General Assemblies,
yes,
Women's Convention, Youth Convention, you know why we have those? To make sure we're saying the same thing.
Yes,
that's
sir.
Right. Amen.
Because if not, you have one church of God, by the way, preaching that Jesus got up on Friday night and died on Sunday morning. You have it rolls up on Thursday morning. And you have so many different different types of Jesus being preached, but it's very important that we, you know, put down and say, hey, listen, this is how we gotta do this. So we have to look at it in the realm of, hey, this is what we preach. This is the same doctrine. Everybody got to be baptized in Jesus' name. Everybody got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And we cannot change that.
That's right.
This is why we have youth meetings, so the youth could understand what holiness is. So the youth could understand how to live right. So the youth could understand what we're preaching. This is why we have the women's meeting, so the women can be the same.
Yes.
Y'all ain't saying nothing. And they say, well, why all those women at that church? You know, they know when we pull up because everybody looks the same.
Yeah.
Because we have something common.
Right.
People start getting out. They said, "Boy, that looks like Redeemer." I remember we was at the park the other day. I said, "Boy, that looks like my daughter's." And they had a long dress on. I said, "Look like my daughter." Sure enough, Valerie, Jeremy, all of them walking in the park. I said, "Boy, I didn't know that was them." I said, "Boy," and then when we go to Walmart and places like that, you start seeing people dressing older. I said, "Man, they must be," and they look like, oh, they must be that holiness. They must be Pentecostal. They must be out of town.
Amen.
When you see this afar off, they say, "Whoa, that look like somebody that must be a part of Redeemer Love." Amen. So that we preach so everybody can be doing the same thing. And the Bible says this. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1.
Yes, sir.
All right. 1:10.
Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
By the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
That ye all speak the same thing.
I want y'all to speak the same thing. We can't, one person saying over here, oh, it's all right. You know, it don't matter how you baptize. And then the other person at that church got a Bible said, oh, we baptized you tonight. And other people say, oh, no, you know, and we just believe. We have to say the same exact thing. If we're going to believe the Bible said that Jesus died on Wednesday night and got up before Sunday morning, then that's what everybody has to believe.
Amen.
You can't have one person over here saying, well, I don't know, I don't have. Listen, if we're together, we're together.
Amen.
There should be no divisions among none of the church.
Amen.
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 If we're all doing one thing and somebody else is doing another, then it looks like you're not with us. That's just like you see all my daughters, everybody out, and then you got one, you know, with a minister on.
Mark them which cause divisions and offenses, which we have learned.
Uh-huh.
And avoid them.
Set markers and avoid them that are teaching something contrary to what you've learned. So if we learn that Jesus didn't die on a Friday night and rose on early Sunday morning, then we can't assemble with that type of thought process.
Amen.
We can't come together and you have somebody saying that Jesus died on Friday night and got up Sunday morning. Because there ain't no Bible back there. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Read,
For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly. And by good words and fair speeches.
And by good words and fair speeches.
Deceive the hearts of the simple.
Deceive the hearts of the simple. Amen. Here we shall. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right. Last scripture. Go back to 1 Corinthians 15. First Corinthians 15 and 1.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preach unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures.
So here we see that we're only saved by which we stand on and what we have already seen, which is based on what we believe in the scriptures, amen.
Amen.
So this is why it's so important for us to hold on to this truth, because it wouldn't make sense for us to believe this one day, and then when people come up and ask us questions, we're fumbling and trying to figure out, well, what do I really believe? Because
right.
Then that's a lost soul on our part. That's blood on your hands, amen.
Yeah.
And then keep reading.
And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures.
According to the scriptures. So going back to the book of Matthew, when it said that we err not, and it also said we know not the power of God. So not only are you erring, but you don't even know the true power of God. So you really don't even know how God really operates really in our lives if you don't even have these scriptures down pat and you remember and stand on them. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm talking about a preacher.
Come on, man.
Ephesians 6.
Go. Thank you, Lord. Glory.
6 and 13.
Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand.
So, Eric Brothers, that's because you can't even stand in the last few days. If you don't remember these scriptures, then hold on to them and receive them. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Can you read it?
Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. And having on the breastplate of righteousness. And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherein ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. But that ye also may know my affairs, and how I do, Tychius, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things.
Go back to verse 14.
Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness.
1 Peter 1 and 13.
Wherefore,
gird up the loins of your mind. So here we go back to dealing with your mind and what you actually receive and what you retain.
That's right.
Amen. So if it says in Ephesians 3 and, or 6 and 14, it said, gird up, and go back to that real quick.
Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth.
Having your loins girded about truth. And what a gird was like a saddle or a type of restraint that held together in the time of weakness. So almost like a like protection when you would play football, so like chin strap, you know, different pads like that. So it would protect you because you already know that when you're in a game or in some kind of environment like that, you already know there's going to be a defense against you. Amen. So when you know this defense, there's a certain characteristics or a certain protection that you have to go about to carry yourself when that time comes, amen.
Amen.
So what the Bible is already saying is, gird up yourself because you already know there's going to be opposition against you, amen. So what is opposition? You have to already be standing firm. And with this opposition, you have to know what kind of protection you need, amen. So when it says gird up your mind, it's not so much a physical battle. That's why I said that we don't war against flesh and blood, amen.
Yes.
But it's a mental battle.
Because
if you lose up here, then it doesn't matter what your physical does, amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Keep reading. Go back to Ephesians 6 and 13.
Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God.
And see, and take the helmet of salvation. This is why a lot of people don't have salvation, because they don't have a helmet. And that's why it doesn't, I've thought about this for years and it still doesn't make sense to me. How can you go to a church and believe for years that from Friday to Sunday is 3 days? And you know it's wrong, but you never challenge it. You know, it kind of makes me believe like you just believe anything.
Yes.
Amen. If you believe anything, you'll fall for anything. Amen. That's why they can't even stand when it goes back to Ephesians 6 through 14. They can't stand on anything because they don't have one, they don't have a helmet.
Right.
That means that they're falling for anything. They don't have true salvation. Amen.
Right. Yes.
And I
hear you. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. But that ye also may know my affairs, and how I do, Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that he might know our affairs, and that he might comfort your hearts. Peace be to the brethren, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all them that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen.
Go back to Galatians 1 and 6.
I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into grace, the grace of Christ, unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we are in
him, there is a perversion of the gospel. Amen. You see that the Bible talks about. There be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel. And when you look at a pervert, it's their job to demise the integrity of what they're praying against or praying on. So there are preachers and people that are in fact praying and perverting the doctrine of Christ.
Yes.
And so this is why it's very vital to make sure that you study the show out, self-approve, have have a man of God that was sent so you can hear from God, so you won't get the perverted version.
Yes.
Because if Jesus was the long hair and blue eyes, that's perverted.
Yes.
The black Jesus with the long hair and braids, dreads, perverted.
Yes.
Jesus dying on Friday night, rising up Sunday morning, perverted. None of these things is in the Bible. When you take things and tamper with the scriptures, you have committed a crime and you perverted the doctrine.
Lord.
Now you're a pervert. Perverted the doctrine. Everybody got to be careful what you listen to and what you hear. Got to be careful what listen. And some people be listening to certain pastors and stuff, they don't know what they're talking about. They can pervert your mind. Amen. Just think about it. A man with long hair, and most men with long hair, you know, they with that sissy stuff.
Yeah. It's true.
Amen.
Amen.
And if they on that sissy stuff, that's perversion. Amen. Why would you have a Jesus with long hair and the Bible says it's a shameful man to have long hair? Perversion. Amen. We can't allow nobody to pervert what we've learned. We can't let nobody pervert what the Bible teaches.
Amen.
Everybody want to shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Everyone standing. We're going to let y'all out of Sunday school early today. Amen. I think we're out of here. Oh, I guess they threw it. Thank God for my son coming up and taking over for a few minutes. Put him on the spot.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
On the spot.
Gotta put him on. I think I did Frankie like that at the old church.
Yes, sir.
Put you on the spot. And we thank God we got sons that can take and keep it going while the people are talking. God, think the new station, they want to be favorable for us and want to talk about our righteous being infringed upon the outside and want to talk with. Apostle talk to, I ain't nothing to say. Amen.
Amen.
I gotta leave that and speak for us.
Yes.
And thank God for it. And you know, standing up for what's right. My father called me from Pennsylvania and said, boy, you done made national news. I said, he said, yeah, he said, man, you made national news, stand up for the church. I said, yeah. That's what we gotta do in this hour. We gotta stand up for what's right.
Yes.